thanks very much for the invitation and to the organizers of the of this workshop. So these projects belongs to an emerging body of research which traces the the historical roots of economic development, and all this literature starts with the work of Acemoglu, Johnson and Robinson that brought the attention to the economies and the relationship between the settled mortality rates and economic development, institutional development today. And after that, there has been a lot of work, and recently there's a lot of studies that look at the persistent effects of African history, and in this respect there's a lot of work done by Nathan and also by Stelios and Elia. And basically what they do is they emphasize the pre-colonial continuity in the form of political realization that affects contemporaneous Africa outcomes. Okay? However, recently, the debate on the historical roots of development has basically concentrated on two basic explanations, which is the effect of institutions and the effect and the role of human capital. And on the one hand, there is the work of Acemoglu, Johnson and Robinson, which basically, and all the subsequent papers, which are the current academic paladins of the institutional view of development. And on the other hand, we have the work of Slafer, Glaser and the co-authors, that what they argue is that human capital is a more important source of development than institutions, and in their view, human capital precedes institutional development. And what they have in mind is that European colonizers brought different amounts of human capital to their colonies, and in places in which there is a high proportion of human capital, then there is a better development, or institutional development, economic development, compared to in places in which there is a low level of human capital. And this original debate between these two explanations has been always at the original debate has taken place at the cross-section level, and basically they try to explain the cross-country differences in economic development. And more recently, this debate has moved at the subnational level. So now they are doing empirical evaluation of these two approaches at the subnational level. There are different work also on this. Okay? And this project finally also belongs to and also on the literature that analyzed the long-term population history economic development, and in this respect there's a work done by Spolarok, Warziak, and Puterman and Whale, and more recently the work of Stenil and Revin. Basically what they argue is that what we really need, they emphasize the importance of directly measuring the colonial European settlement at the early stage of colonization, and that's what basically we do in this project. So what's our contribution on all this literature? So this literature has emphasized the importance of European in shaping human capital and institutions in the colonies. And in the way they have done this basically is using a proxy for the identity of the colonizer or the legal origin, and also the proportion of European settlements. But they have done this in periods in which that are very far away from the early periods of the early colonization. So in periods, it's what we call the more recent past, and in different years for different countries. So what we do is basically we have access to the data of the first colonizers that moved to Latin America, and we have information on the name, the city of origin, the destination, the occupation, etc. Okay? And this data would allow us to construct different measures on the level of instructions on the first settlers that moved to Latin America. And not always this, but also we can do it for the different destination points. Okay? So for each destination, we can have the proportion of the people with more instruction, more human capital, different type of occupation, etc. So we believe that the colonization period and the biographical information on these early settlers provide a unique opportunity to advance in the debate of what's the role of human capital in explaining institutional development and economic development, conflict, etc. So where the data comes from? So the data we discover that there's a lot of information in the Archivo de las Indias, it's an archive in Seville, and basically there is the best source of information on the Europeans that moved to America from 1492. Until 1668, the only legal port to departure to Latin America was Seville. And this is very important because this means that all the travelers to Latin America were controlled in Seville. But the important word that we are using is the word done by this linguistic Peter Boyd Bowman, who has spent many years in the Archivo de Indias working with this information and has the information on the, on the ones that really make it and arrive to Latin America, okay? So he has the work of the geographical index of 56,000 colonizers of America. And they have the city of origin, the place of destination, also the city in which they died in Latin America, the occupation, and etc. So how the data look like? This, I translate this in English. For example, this person is Hernan Gomez that comes from the town Tui in Pontevedra and first arrived in Las Indias in 1512, okay, but then finally he moved to Yakimo, okay, in 1514. So this person will put as destiny is Yakimo in 1415, okay? So the fact that we can geographically locate these first pobladores in America provide a very nice source of variation to investigate what's the role of human capital in shaping local institutions and development and conflict, okay? So just to give you a little bit of how the colonization works, the Spanish settlers did not stay in the coast for a long time. They immediately penetrated to the continent and they found cities in the continent. So in a very short period of time, they settled in a very large territory with very diverse geography, very diverse cultures, and very diverse climate, okay? So they go, the expansion in this short period goes from the north of Mexico, Zacatecas, to Buenos Aires. And in fact, when we see that the destination point, we see that these two points were reached in less than 50 years. And this will be the period that we will be working, okay? So now we have codified information from 1492 until 1540. We have 29,803 travelers, okay? And the total destinations is 228, okay? So just to give you an idea of the work, this codification was not very easy to do. And at the time, so many of the destinations, the point of the settlement was not very clear. Sometimes we have places like that he moved to Indias or Tierra Firme. So what we have done is just what means Tierra Firme in a particular year in time. And what we discover in many cases that this Tierra Firme at a particular moment in time was just one settlement, okay? So this person was associated to this particular settlement. And to do this, we use the work of Lope de Velasco in 1573. He was a cartographer that was sent to the Americas in 1573, okay? To do, well, he did it in 3 years from 1570 to 1573. So he was sent there to have an idea of where the people settled for the last 60, 70 years, okay? So this tells that they will have no idea where people move, okay? So this is just giving an idea of all the points we are using with all the travelers from 1492 to 1540. But of course, since there are points that were settled very early, okay, and we just want to take the first travelers, with the ones that they have no idea where they were moving, okay, we are just going to use for analysis the travelers that moved the first 5 years after the first traveler moved there, okay? So these, for example, travelers in each point, the first year after the first travel, the first traveler arrived, the second, third, fourth, and fifth, okay? So that's the information we are going to use for the analysis. Let me just tell you an idea where these people were coming from. So just to tell you an idea how heterogeneous were. So people believe that everybody was from Andalusia. These were just during the first 10 and 15 years. After 15 years, only 37%. And the rest were distributed between Castilla-La Mancha, Castilla-León, Extremadura, etc. Okay? And this is just to give you an idea that the travelers were heterogeneously distributed around the continent. Okay? So the important variable we are interested is on what we call the human capital or the level of instruction. So in all these travelers, we find 274 different occupations. So the occupations were like banker, lawyer, pharmacist, barber, etc. So it were very heterogeneous. So what we need to do with this information is to construct what we call a dictionary of occupational titles. So we need to match each occupation with a level of instruction. And this was also not easy to do because we need to know exactly at this moment in time in history, in 1500 what means each of the different occupations. So for example, for the escribanos, we know that they need to pass an exam that proves if they know how to use the technical book. So this person will be considered literate, okay? So doing this, we distributed in four different levels. We call here literate, probably literate, and illiterate, but in fact there are just different levels, so it does not have to be exactly literate or probably literate, okay? So at the highest we have people like what we call the escribanos, which are, for example, lawyers, people that have a college degree at that moment, with a lawyer, doctors, mathematicians, okay, or theologians, okay? And then we have the second level, which, for example, here is a person that were in charge of managing an inheritance, okay? And we know that this person probably was probably literate, but not at the level with a college degree of the other group, okay? And then we have people, for example, that need to drive a small boat, okay? So they need to know some knowledge. We don't know exactly if literate or not, so we put probably illiterate, but we don't know exactly. And then people like construction workers, etc., that we consider in the latest category. Okay, but again, this can be different. We can do different categories. We can just put four levels of instruction that don't have to be literate or illiterate. So the majority of them were illiterate, but still there is a significant proportion of literate and probably illiterate people. And the important thing is that you will see that in the map that they are not all equally distributed. So although we have very proportion of literate or illiterate, among the 228 points, more than 100 or 101, the majority in this particular destination were literate people. Okay, so this is how the distribution of the literate looks like. Okay, but here is still with all the travelers until 50-40. And as I told you before, we're going to use just the travelers during the first 5 years after the first traveler arrived to the destination point. Okay? So an important thing is what's the identification strategy in this analysis. So the question is the localization of this first settler's occupation really random? So, since we're using the period immediately after the initial colonization, the 1492 to 1540, and only the first 5 years after the first traveler arrived, so the difference in the occupational structure of the first settlers is likely to be accidental, okay? And moreover, just remember that in the alternative used in the part where the researcher used instruments which are questionable, okay, and also they use the current or the recent past level of human capital. So we believe that this approach at least improves the methodology that has been used previously in the literature. Okay? So there are many passages in the books of the time that support our idea that the distribution of occupation of the settlers across settlement is likely to be accidental. So let me tell you a little bit how the west of the conquest worked. So the early settlers were until 1573 members of what we call the Oeste Conquistadora, and these were not soldiers as we understand. They were not militaries. The soldiers that formed the Western Conquistadora were basically people, farmers, there were bankers, architects, or ranchers, whatever, okay? So basically the way it works is that a person with some little bit of money decided to go to the Americas, probably because he was very ambitious. So he go to the king and sign a contract, which is called a capitulación. And basically capitulación tell you it was a latitude, longitude, just a straight line that tell you need to go to that direction. Don't go to another one direction because you will find another conquistador, okay? And basically, then this person go to the center usually of their own village, okay? And they put a table with an announcement, and then there are voluntaries that say, I want to enroll in this Oeste, okay? This means that you need to sign, and you cannot leave the Oeste from that point. If you leave the Oeste after you sign, then you will be killed, okay? So that's to ensure that the Oeste will move together to the Americas. And then when they arrive there, they divide the ones that arrive, the ones that make it and survive. Then they divide the land and the indigenous people depending on how much effort each conquistador, each member of the Oeste Conquistadora participate. Okay? People that brought, for example, horses, they will have probably more land than people that have not brought any horses. People that risk a lot of their life and fight a lot, then they will have more land and more indigenous compared to the ones that have not done absolutely anything. Okay? And the way in which they were localized, basically these chronicles of the time say that basically the localization was based on the intuition of the conqueror and on the possibility that there were indigenous there, so they have the workforce to work, okay? And formally, from Spain, the only condition to settle is that they need to follow the rules of the Santo Tomás de Aquino. And basically what they say is that the characteristic that the land should have and that the founder should follow: access to potable water, proximity to construction materials, forests, cultivable land, etc. So a place that people could live, which has sense, okay? Nobody will settle in a place in which there's no water, okay? So the conqueror, when before going there, knows very little about the characteristics of the territory they will conquer. So there's no reason to believe that he will select the professions or the occupations based on the characteristics of the land he will conquer. Okay? And apart from that, we are going to compare destinations that are occupied but with different social structures, okay, or different occupational structure. And finally, we are going to check the exogeneity of the location of the distribution of the people and the location, checking whether if the geographical characteristics of the areas that were occupied by illiterate compared to the areas that were occupied by illiterate are different or not. And we will see that basically they are exactly the same, okay? So what's the methodology? So ideally, the methodology I told you is very preliminary. Ideally, we're going to work by municipality and with buffers around these settlement points. Okay? At the moment, we don't have the data constructed yet, so we are just going to use some data that we have from other works, and we are going to work with cells of 1 degree by 1 degree. Okay? And let me tell you that the variables of interest are whether there is an early settlement or not in this grid, and the density and the type of settlements at the moment, okay? So these are the color area are the areas of the colonization. All the areas except the purple one are colonization areas before 1540, okay? But although the purple are the latest one, okay? You can see all the settlements we have are basically in all these areas except the purple. And the Colombia part, although it's purple, the settlements are before 1540. So let me just show you an old map in which the points that are in the Colombia part are in 1510, 1515, okay? So in this map they are in the purple in this area just because probably the settlement, the period in which we need a lot of population to move there was harder, probably because there were more indigenous rebellion from the original cultures in the America, okay? But the settlements were also before 1540, okay? We are going to just check on the per capita income using the highlight from the satellites, and then also the spatial inequality using also the night light density of light at night, okay? But this is just very preliminary, okay? So specification will be very simple. We're going to check whether settlements of these characteristics affect the per capita income and the inequality, okay? And we're going to control, of course, by geography, climate, and quality of the soil, distance to potable water, etc., okay, for each area. But this is very preliminary. I mean, it's very cautious because this won't be the final analysis. It's just analysis with the data we have now, okay? So first, what we check is that it looks like the areas that were early colonized have much more per capita income, okay, but also you have much more spatial inequality. And here, this tell us that, and this analysis will be in the future, that the early settlements, since they were a very few families distributing a lot of the land when they arrived, they have a lot of privileges. Probably this is what the origin of this inequality that are in all the Latin America. But that's what we are going to do it in a future project, okay? And the same with the human capital, so we have just checked the coefficient from literate seems to be higher than the coefficient of illiterate to explain per capita income, but this is very preliminary and we don't want to push anything on this at the moment, okay, because we need to do much more work on this.